Hello and a very warm welcome to Rajya Sabha Television. You're watching the news tonight with me, Frank Rousen Pereira. Here are the headlines. Rajya Sabha sees protests for the third day on the PNB fraud special status to Andhra Pradesh and the Kaveri issue. Despite short duration discussion listed on bank fraud and government's willingness to discuss all issues, Congress, TMC, TDP, DMK and AIADMK members failed to heed the chairman's appeals to allow the house to function. Rajya Sabha chairman terms vandalism of statues of leaders in Tripura, West Bengal and Tamil Nadu as sheer madness. Prime Minister warns of stern action against those found guilty. Home Ministry directs states to prevent such incidents. All party meeting to end impasse in the Lok Sabha over the PNB fraud remains inconclusive. Opposition party is adamant on their demand for a discussion under a rule that entails voting and the Prime Minister's reply on the issue. Centre ready to give special package to Andhra Pradesh. Finance Minister Arun Jaitley says it will be the monetary equivalent of a special status for the state. And DNS allowance for government employees and pensioners hiked to 7% from 5% from January 1, 2018. Union Cabinet approves measures to facilitate investments and enhance ease of doing business in the telecom sector. Well, the Rajya Sabha could not transact any business on Wednesday for the third day in a row as members protested over the PNB fraud and other issues. Chairman M. Venkaiah Naidu expressed anguish over the continued protest despite the discussion on the bank fraud being allowed and listed in the day's agenda. He also strongly condemned incidents of vandalism of statues in different parts of the country. Here's more.
After formal business ended in the Rajya Sabha on Wednesday, there were protests by members on several issues. The Congress and the TMC sought to raise the issue of the PNB fraud, while the AIADMK and the DMK demanded constitution of the Kaveri Water Management Board. The TDP and a Congress member demanded special status to Andhra Pradesh. The chairman repeatedly urged members to allow the house to function, as a short duration discussion on bank fraud was already listed.
This bank issue is a very important issue. Let us start the discussion. Please go back to your respective seats. Entire country want discussion. Please go back to your seat. Every issue is important. Kaveri is important. Andhra is important. This bank issue also is important. I am ready to permit all discussions, but provided if the house is in order.
The chairman also sternly disapproved of statues being vandalized.
It's mad whoever does it, whether it is Tamil Nadu, whether it is West Bengal, whether it is Tripura. Whoever does it, it's mad, and appropriate authorities, I hope, will take firm action. That's the view.
As the protest continued, the chairman adjourned the house till 2 p.m.
The house is adjourned to meet at the 2 p.m. in the afternoon.
The protest continued even in the post-lunch session. With no visible respite in sight, the chair adjourned the house till Thursday.
Adjourned up to tomorrow morning.
Chairman once again assured the members that he would allow discussion on all issues under appropriate rules. In fact, a short duration discussion on reported scams in some public sector banks and failure of banking regulators to check them was listed. But due to disruptions, members could not participate in an edifying debate to find solutions to fix the problem. Reporting from Parliament, with Kanaperson Manoj, I'm Kriti Mishra for Rajya Sabha Television.
Well, the uproar continued in the Lok Sabha as well. As soon as the House met for the day, opposition members refused to allow the House to function. After the House was adjourned for the day, Speaker Sumitra Mahajan convened a meeting with the leaders to appeal for the smooth functioning of the House.
In order to end the disruptions in the Lok Sabha, Speaker Sumitra Mahajan on Wednesday appealed to all parties to allow the House to function smoothly. She urged party leaders to raise their demands in a proper manner and find a solution.
मैंने सबको यही रिक्वेस्ट की है कि आप आपस में बातचीत करो, क्योंकि जो भी दृश्य जाता है वो ठीक नहीं जाता है। लोकसभा देखने के लिए भी बाहर के देशों से भी लोग आते हैं, या हमारे भी बच्चे गैलरी में भी बैठे रहते हैं, घर घर में बैठे हुए लोग देखते हैं, और कहीं ना कहीं पार्लियामेंट का उद्देश्य जो है वो थोड़ा सा इधर उधर हो जाता है।
Meanwhile, protests continued in Parliament for the third day on various issues, including the Punjab National Bank fraud case. The House was first adjourned till 12 p.m. and then for the day.
कुछ मसले ऐसे हैं कि जिनका हल लोकसभा से वैसे नहीं हो सकता जिस तरीके से चाहते हैं, और मैंने यही कहा है कि अलग-अलग मसले होते हैं, मगर लोकसभा कोई भी आपका मामला हो उसको उठाने के लिए, किसी नियम के अंतर्गत उठाने के लिए अनुमति देने के लिए है, और वो हम दे देंगे।
The Congress and the TMC raised the issue of Punjab National Bank fraud case and asked Prime Minister Narendra Modi to give a reply. The TDP pressed for special status to Andhra Pradesh, while AIADMK members trooped into the well demanding the constitution of Kaveri Management Board. The TRS demanded raising the reservation quota beyond 50% in Telangana. Ravindra Singh Shiran's report for Rajya Sabha TV.
Finance Minister Arun Jaitley on Wednesday announced that an amount equivalent to special status will be given to Andhra Pradesh. Jaitley clarified that after the 14th Finance Commission, the concept of special category status had ceased to exist. The centre also decided to create special purpose vehicle in Andhra Pradesh that deals with development of the state. Here's more.
Addressing the Telugu Desam Party's demand for special category status to Andhra Pradesh, Finance Minister Arun Jaitley said a special package will be given to the state that will have the same monetary benefits. The centre is also open to providing external funding or loans through the National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development. The finance minister added that provisions for revenue deficit in Andhra Pradesh, as per the Finance Commission, had already been implemented, and tax incentives were also given in the budget.
That external agencies, World Bank, Asian Development Bank, JICA, they support programs in Andhra. That money is to be repaid back, should be repaid 90% by the center. And a sum equivalent to the monetary compensation or the monetary compensation equivalent of special category status will come by externally aided programs, which are to be repaid 90-10. Center has agreed. We even today stand by them.
The demand for a special category status has its origin in claims that the bifurcation of erstwhile Andhra Pradesh has caused a huge revenue deficit. However, after the centre accepted the 14th Finance Commission's recommendation in 2015 to devolve an unprecedented 42% of union tax revenues to states against the previous 32%, the concept of special category status ceased to exist.
The special status used to be originally granted to states in the Northeast because they had their own resources which were inadequate, their own revenue was inadequate. At that time, special category states as a concept did exist. But when the 14th Finance Commission report came, which is a constitutional award, they said there is no special category status now to be given.
The Telugu Desam Party, a partner in the BJP-led National Democratic Alliance government, and other parties from Andhra Pradesh are holding protests in Parliament over the demand of special status.
Finance Minister Arun Jaitley stressed that the centre has a positive attitude towards Andhra Pradesh because the state suffered during bifurcation. He also reiterated that the centre was committed to fulfilling all the conditions of Andhra Pradesh Reorganisation Act. He, however, clarified that political sentiments cannot decide the quantum of funds to be given to a state. Reporting from Delhi, with cameraperson Junaid Khan, I'm Kriti Mishra for Rajya Sabha Television.
Well, the Union Cabinet today increased the dearness allowance for 11 million employees and pensioners to 7% from 5% from January 1st, 2018. According to a government statement, the hike will benefit about 48.41 lakh central government employees and 61.17 lakh pensioners. The Union Cabinet also approved two key measures in the telecom sector that are aimed at facilitating investments and enhance ease of doing business. It also approved the Commercial Courts Bill for introduction in Parliament. Other decisions included approval of an agreement between India and France on the prevention of the illicit consumption and reduction of illicit traffic in narcotic drugs, psychotropic substances and chemical precursors and related offences. Well, the BJP on Wednesday renewed its criticism of former finance minister and Congress leader P. Chidambaram on the 80-20 gold import scheme. Law Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad questioned as to why trading houses, including Geetanjali Gems, that's at the center of the PNB fraud, were allowed to import gold just a day before the 2014 Lok Sabha results were to be announced. He also shared an office memorandum of the Finance Ministry dated May 15, 2014, saying the trading houses were allowed to import gold. The Congress had refuted the allegation yesterday. The UPA government in August 2013 introduced the 80-20 rule that allowed traders to import gold only after they had exported 20% of the gold from their previous import. The rule was scrapped in November 2014 after the NDA came to power.
अनैतिकता की पराकाष्ठा है राजनीतिक अनैतिकता की कि चुनाव के रिजल्ट के एक दिन पहले आप ये फैसला कर रहे हैं और आपके दस्तखत के बाद ये फाइल इतनी स्पीड पकड़ता है कि 9 डेस्क से एक दिन में गुजरता है और उसी दिन 15 मई 2014 को रिजर्व बैंक भेज दिया जाता है.
कर्नाटका लोकायुक्त पी विश्वनाथ शेट्टी वाज ऑन वेडनेसडे स्टैब्ड मल्टीपल टाइम्स इन हिज ऑफिस व्हाइल हियरिंग अ केस. द जज वाज रश्ड टू अ नियरबाय हॉस्पिटल एंड इज स्टेटेड टू बी आउट ऑफ डेंजर. The accused, who was identified as Tejraj Sharma, attacked Shetty in his chamber. According to news reports, the attacker had filed a complaint with the Lokayukta about not getting a tender for some work he had applied for. He stabbed him after being told that the case was shut after investigation. Chief Minister Siddaramaiah also rushed to the hospital to meet Shetty. He confirmed the arrest of the attacker and also assured strict action for lapse of security. Well, in a convocation address at the Aligarh Muslim University, President Ramnath Kovind said diversity and an open-minded approach were great sources of strength for the country. President Kovind said acceptance of alternative ways of thinking and mutual respect are not just slogans but India's natural way of life. Kovind also welcomed the role of Aligarh Muslim University while stating that students of AMU have made their mark not only in India but also in the other parts of the world, particularly in Asia and Africa.
बदलती हुई जरूरतों और माहौल के अनुसार नॉलेज क्रिएशन हो सके आधुनिकता के लिए विज्ञान और टेक्नोलॉजी के साथ साथ प्रगतिशील सोच की भी जरूरत होती है जिसके मुताबिक समाज का हर तबका बराबरी और भाईचारे के साथ आगे बढ़ता रहे.
Well, it's time for a short break now, but news and updates will continue on the other side. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
What is the actual story of women's empowerment in India? Have they really reached the place where they should have been?
मैं अगर बस में बैठती हूँ और वहाँ पे मुझे सिर्फ उसी लिए सीट मिलेगा, just because I'm a woman, I wouldn't want it.
India figures 148th in the Committee of Nations as far as participation of women in governance is concerned.
I personally support the idea that there should be some reservation for women just to change the culture.
And education, I think, does need to improve to a great extent. And I think in villages at the moment, from what I have seen in my neighborhood,
all workplaces are notorious for sexual harassment. They just don't come up. What I want to reiterate is that you need to speak up.
It's high time, instead of stopping your girls, you know, don't talk like this, don't wear those clothes, don't behave like that. It's high time, start educating your boys. Okay. That treat them well.
Okay.
We take men as the standard. I feel that's the wrong way of looking at it.
Okay.
Let's take women as the standard if you're wanting to read somewhere.
Watch an enriching discussion on the journey of Indian women so far in the Pulse Show on Rajya Sabha Television.
Let's meet the participants for today's North Zone semi-finals. We have the team from Chandigarh, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Jammu and Kashmir, Punjab. Finally, we have the team from Uttarakhand. This is a 2017 Indian movie, which is the entry for the best foreign language film at the Oscar Awards.
Newton.
Newton is the right answer. 10 points to the team from Jammu and Kashmir. Pehli baar, is flag ka istemal Singapore mein hua tha.
Bhartiya Tiranga.
Is not the right answer. Team from Chandigarh.
Indian National Congress.
Galat jawab, -5 to the team from Chandigarh. Which country's parliament building is this?
Nepal.
Nepal is not the right answer. Teams in the buzzers now.
Afghanistan.
Afghanistan is the right answer. 10 points to the team from Haryana.
Watch National Elections Quiz 2018. Presented by Election Commission of India. Saturday at 5 p.m. Only on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back. You're watching Rajya Sabha Television. Well, Prime Minister Narendra Modi strongly condemned the incidents of vandalism of statues in some states and warned of stern action against those found guilty. In an advisory to all states and union territories, the Home Ministry asked the states concerned to take all measures necessary to prevent such incidents.
Vandalism of statues that started in Tripura reached Tamil Nadu, West Bengal and Uttar Pradesh by Wednesday. Prime Minister Narendra Modi strongly condemned the incidents and warned of stern action against the violators. The Home Ministry ordered all states to keep a check on such incidents and cautioned that senior government and police officers will be held responsible for vandalized statues.
हमारी पार्टी के राष्ट्रीय अध्यक्ष ने भी कहा है कि यदि कोई भी किसी के संबंध में कोई शिकायत यदि मिलेगी तो आवश्यक कार्रवाई भी की जाएगी और मैं सभी राजनीतिक पार्टियों से भी अपील करना चाहता हूं कि अपने अपने कार्यकर्ताओं को यह स्पष्ट निर्देश दें कि कहीं इस प्रकार की किसी हरकत में कोई इन्वॉल्व न हो.
BJP chief Amit Shah also termed the desecration of statues extremely unfortunate and asserted that any party member found destroying a statue will face severe action. He also called upon his party units to exercise restraint in both Tamil Nadu and Tripura.
इस बहुदलीय लोकतंत्र को हमको बरकरार रखना होगा और सभी विचारधाराओं के बारे में सम्मान रखते हुए साथ में जाना होगा इसलिए ऐसे मूर्तियों का भंग करने का और हमले करने का ये सारे घटनाओं का मैं घोर निंदा करता हूं.
The center stepped in a day after a Lenin statue was pulled down in Tripura. A bust of BJP icon Shyama Prasad Mukherjee was damaged in Kolkata. West Bengal police detained at least 6 persons in connection with the incident.
একটা সিদ্ধান্ত নেওয়া হয়েছে যে মূর্তিটাকে ঘিরে দেওয়া হবে প্রথমে ঘিরে দিয়ে এখানকার যারা পাথরের কাজ করে
তবে দিয়ে
কিন্তু যারা পাথরের কাজ করে সেই ধরনের মিস্ত্রিকে ডেকে এই পাথরটিকে সম্পূর্ণ আগের যে রূপ ছিল সেইভাবে তৈরি করে দেওয়া হবে.
In Tamil Nadu, a statue of Dravidian movement founder E.V. Ramasamy Periyar was allegedly vandalized in Vellore district on Tuesday night. A massive protest erupted after BJP leader H. Raja wrote a controversial post on a social media site. The protest was led by DMK leaders against H. Raja's comments. However, Raja later expressed regret.
So I appeal to everybody to maintain calm and peace. Though it was done by my admin and I had no intention of injuring anybody's feeling.
On the other hand, a petrol bomb was thrown at a BJP office in Coimbatore during early hours of Wednesday. No one was hurt. Tamil Nadu police detained the violators. Bureau report, Rajya Sabha Television.
Along to developments in the PNB fraud case now, where the Delhi High Court has sought the response of the Enforcement Directorate on Nirav Modi's firm Firestar Diamonds' plea against the agency's proceedings in the case. Meanwhile, the Serious Fraud Investigation Office has recorded the statement of the Managing Director and CEO of the Punjab National Bank in connection with the fraud case. On Tuesday, the senior officials of the private sector lenders Axis Bank and ICICI Bank appeared before the agency in connection with the probe. Axis Bank revealed that it has a 200 crore rupee exposure to the scam-tainted companies promoted by Nirav Modi and his uncle Mehul Choksi. The CBI has arrested Vipul Chitalia, the vice president of Geetanjali Group of Companies, as a part of the probe into the case. The court has remanded him in CBI custody till March 17th. Chitalia was detained at the Mumbai airport when he returned to India from Dubai. The agency has also taken custody of a retired deputy manager of the Punjab National Bank. Well, the deadline for mandatory linking of Aadhaar to avail government schemes may be further extended beyond March 31st. The centre told the Supreme Court that since more time is needed to conclude the prolonged hearing in the Aadhaar case, the deadline may extend from March 31st. A five-judge constitution bench headed by Chief Justice Deepak Mishra agreed with the centre's contention on the issue. On December 15th last year, the Apex Court had extended the deadline for mandatory linking of Aadhaar with various services and welfare schemes till March 31st. The Apex Court is hearing several petitions challenging Aadhaar. Well, senior NDPP leader Nephew Rio will take oath as Nagaland Chief Minister on Thursday. Rio was appointed as Chief Minister Designate by Governor P.B. Acharya after receiving letters of support from 12 legislators of the BJP, one from the JDU and another from an independent MLA besides the 18 MLAs of the NDPP. The Governor also asked Rio to prove his majority on the floor of the House on or before March 16th. Earlier on Tuesday, outgoing Chief Minister T.R. Zeeliang submitted his resignation, which was accepted by the Governor. His party, the Naga People's Front, was the largest single party, but with a tally of 27 seats, fell well short of the magic number of 31. Well, Biplab Deb will be sworn in as the first BJP Chief Minister of Tripura on March 9th. His name was unanimously decided in a meeting of the newly elected MLAs of BJP and its ally IPFT in Agartala on Tuesday. Jishnu Kumar Deb Barma, a prominent tribal leader and member of Tripura's royal family, will take over as the deputy chief minister of the state. The BJP and IPFT combined had swept to power in the state, winning 43 out of the 59 seats for which elections were held. The BJP had won 35 and IPFT 8 seats.
किसी ने भी कुछ भी राज्य में ऐसा कोई घटना घटाने की कोशिश करेगा और जिन्होंने भी कुछ भी किया है पूरे कड़ाई से उसका व्यवस्था की जाएगी किसी को बख्शा नहीं जाएगा।
Well, Delhi's Indira Gandhi International Airport has been rated as the number one among airports in the world, handling more than 4 crore passengers annually. The rating has been given in a survey by the Airports Council International, that is a trade association of 1,953 member airports across 176 countries. As part of its survey on airport service quality, views of passengers on 34 key performance indicators are measured. Delhi has topped the list in the highest category. Well, the Mumbai International Airport, meanwhile, has topped the list on the customer experience category. Well, President Ramnath Kovind will present the Nari Shakti Puraskars 2017 to 30 individuals and 9 institutional awardees at a special ceremony at the Rashtrapati Bhavan on International Women's Day tomorrow. The government gives Nari Shakti Puraskars to eminent women and institutions in recognition of their service towards the cause of women empowerment. The Ministry of Women and Child Development announces these national level awards for eminent women, organizations and institutions. Well, South Korea has said the North is willing to talk to the United States about giving up its nuclear weapons after an unprecedented meeting between the North and South. Seoul's national security chief said North Korean leader Kim Jong-un has agreed to refrain from conducting nuclear and missile tests while engaging in dialogue with South Korea. The security chief also said that North Korea clarified that it had no reason to retain nuclear weapons if the military threat to North Korea is resolved and the country's security can be guaranteed. Meanwhile, China said it is very happy to see the positive outcomes that came out of the recent South Korean special envoy's talks in North Korea. Well, let's now take a look at some more updates from across the world in Global Buzz. Well, the White House's top economic advisor, Gary Cohen, resigned over differences with U.S. President Donald Trump on his trade policy. Cohen, who is a former Goldman Sachs executive, resigned as the White House National Economic Council director after Trump's decision to impose a 25% tariff on import of steel and 10% on aluminium. China's finance minister Xiao Jie said reduction of taxes and fees by a large margin has not affected China's fiscal revenue. Speaking about China's year-on-year fiscal revenue growth of 7.4% last year, given a 3 trillion yuan cut of taxes and fees, he said that the fiscal revenue has a positive correlation with the economic growth. People of Sierra Leone queued early at the polling stations to vote for a successor to President Ernest Bai Koroma in an election dominated by an economic crisis caused by a collapse in iron ore prices and an Ebola epidemic. 16 candidates are contesting for the top job. A civil war in the 1990s wrecked Sierra Leone's economy, and the country has been in deep poverty due to the outbreak of the deadly Ebola crisis and falling global commodity prices that affected iron ore. Well, the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights War Monitor said that airstrikes in eastern Ghouta in Syria killed at least 19 people, including 4 children, today. The United Nations believes 4 lakh people are still trapped inside the enclave, where food and medical supplies were already running short before the airstrikes began 2 weeks ago. Well, the death toll rose to 39 in the Russian military transport plane, which crashed in Syria. The death toll was revised after an initial report of 32 dead. Russian Defense Ministry said all of the dead were military personnel. An investigation is underway to find the cause of the crash. Well, with that, it's a wrap on this newscast. Good night.